God in unique, special ways today. And I want to thank God for the testimonies we have been hearing. They've been awesome and mind-blowing. I want to believe, God, that you shall not miss your own. And in this hour of revival, in this season of revival, I pray, God, that all God has packaged for you and for this generation, you shall not miss anyone. It is a time to engage your heart in whatever God is doing, a time to engage your heart in whatever God has prepared for his people. Because God does everything in seasons. And it makes the heart of God to bleed if we miss our times. Because our times are in God's hands, really. But everything God does on earth, he does them in times, in seasons. That's the way it works. And God does everything beautiful in his own time. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11. And whatever God doeth is forever. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 14. If it is God that is doing it, the devil cannot spoil it. So it's important for us to make sure that Jesus does not weep on us. He looked at Jerusalem. He wept over Jerusalem. He said, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, why did he weep? And if you understand, when Jesus got to the Lazarus tomb, he wept. But that one is different from the one in Jerusalem. The weeping there is with a loud voice, lamentable voice. It was painful to him that Jerusalem was missing its times. And I pray none of us shall miss our times with God. Because when you miss it, it pains him. Because it's like everything is organized in system, in structures. That's the way God works. So I pray you will not miss your season. I pray I will not miss my season. I pray our children will not miss their seasons, and none of us shall miss our timings with God in the name of Jesus. We shall be on target with God. We shall be at the right places, at the right times, doing the right things, and getting the right results with the right people at the right time. In the matchless and most powerful name of Jesus. Understand, this is a season of revival. This is revival that will never stop. This is the revival that will usher in the Lord God Almighty. When we're talking about revival, we're talking at a time when men's hearts begin to pant after God, begin to yearn after God. It's a heart issue first. That's number one. It's a heart issue. It's a time of holiness. It's a time of righteousness that you are not forced. It's just your heart is yearning towards it. Look at what Psalm 42 verse 1 says. And verse 2, it says, as the heart panted after the water brooks, so panted my soul after thee, O God. This is revival. So panted my soul after thee. I pray that everything about us, our soul, our spirit, and our body will begin to gravitate towards God like never before. Verse 2 says, and tested for God. For the living God, where shall I come and appear before my God? Wow! You see, that's the way it works. That's number one. When your heart begins to pant after God, that is what revival is. You know, a longing of the heart. And remember that God sees our heart. Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 10. He said, I search the hearts and the reins of men. To give every man what he deserves. So God looks at our heart. It's our heart that is the issue. 2 Chronicles chapter 25, verse 2. Amaziah did all that was right in the sight of the Lord, but not with a perfect heart. It starts from within. Revival starts from within and outward. It's not an outward show. It's an inside work that the outward will just respond. The outward responds. It's not the outward showing off. No, it's that what will just respond. because your heart will be stirred up to seek after God. Nobody will be pushing you. You will pant after it. Panting is a strong word, higher than desire. It's a strong word. You'll be panting after God, after His kingdom, after His righteousness. That's the way you'll be driven so hard. It's a long game. God, panting after all your heart. It's important for us to understand that. It's a heart issue. Because God looks at the heart. He deals with us from the inside out. That's the way God works. In 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 7, He said, men look at the outward, but I, God, I look at the inward. And that is the way God works. And that's how it is with Him. So the inside is more important to God than the outside show. The outside responds to what is inside. And that is what is endurable. And that is what God wants. In fact, greater is He that is in us, not just outside, than He that is in the world. What is inside is greater than what is outside. So it's important for us to understand that it's a question of the heart, a longing of the heart towards God, towards His kingdom, and every of God's interest. That's what revival is all about. In Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 13, it says, you shall seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. That's what revival is all about. When you seek me with all your heart. And in Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 21, he said, who is it that engages his heart to seek me? Who is it? God will look out for the person. He said, God's eyes run to and fro the earth. Yes. Seeking for those whose heart are panting after him. So understand it. This revival is not going to end. This is the revival that will usher in the last harvest before the emergence of our Lord Jesus Christ. You are going to see harvest of souls, going to see open demonstration of holiness, righteousness, of kingdom wealth that is quite and well articulated. Not the one that is misused for personal aggrandizement. No, the one that is for the kingdom and for the kingdom enhancement. That's the way it works. Number two. Revival is when people begin to take pleasure in the things of the kingdom. That is it. God becomes first. Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. He says, seek you first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all other things shall be added unto you. Unfortunately, humanity seeks after all those things that should be added unto us, instead of seeking the God that owns all those things. The earth and the fullness thereof is the Lord. Psalm 24 is the Lord. And there is nothing anybody can do about it. Anything you're seeking for is the Lord. When you seek God tacitly with all your heart, fervently with all your spirit, then there is no way God will not add those things to you. That's the way it was. Romans chapter 12, verse 11. It says, be not slothful. That is, don't be lazy. But be fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. That is revival. I want to pray that none of us shall make the mistakes again of seeking things. Because this is, you must key into this revival. In Psalm 102, verses 13 through 15, it talks about the same simple thing. He said, those that take pleasure in the stones of Zion, then what happens? God will naturally breathe upon them. Let me read it so that you will get it clear. Hallelujah. Psalm 102. Psalm 102, verse 13 says, thou shalt arise and have mercy upon Zion, for the time to favor her. Yea, the set time is come. There is always a set time for everything. This is the time of God's revival, the time to favor God's people. You are going to see the demonstration of God's favor like never before. People will openly be identifying with God. They will come to you, they say, take me to your God. Why? Because they'll be seeing the proofs and the evidences of the gospel in our lives. As we keep seeking Him, thou see verse 14, it says, For thy servants take pleasure in her stones, and favor the dust thereof. Can you see that? So the heathen shall hear the name of the Lord, shall fear the name of the Lord, and all the kings of the earth thy glory. In other words, not everybody. It's only those that are keen in the revival that favor the stones of Zion. Everything that has to do with God ignites their passion. And then God will begin to show evidences, decorations in their lives that will amaze many. And then as people, the kings, the nobles see those things, they'll be rushing to God. I pray that you understand that these are the days of good news. That is the way it happens. Now, let me tell you something. Number one, what you don't expect, your eyes cannot see. That's why this preaching, so that you can begin to expect it. You can key in so that you don't miss your time of visitation. This is the time of revival. Genesis chapter 13, verse 15. He said, look, 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 look. For what you see, that is what you are going to get. That's the way it works. In Jeremiah chapter 1, he said, what do you see? And when he saw well, that God said, you have seen well. Now hasten my word to perform it. So when you see well, you begin to possess well. Beloved, what you don't expect, your eyes cannot see it. And you cannot get it. Number two, note this. Mentality is what defines your destiny. Mentality is what defines your destiny. You can't see it. Until you get there in your mind. That's why to listen to good preachers, good teachers, reading good books helps you a lot. Helps your mind. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is it. Proverbs 23 verse 7. So mentality is what defines destiny. Mentality brings color to your destiny. If you're barren in your mind, then you're finished. As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Oh yes, where the mind goes, the man goes. That's the way it works. Where the mind goes, the man goes. So your mentality defines your destiny. And number three, I can tell you one short thing. God has no agenda for backward movement for us. Never. His agenda is forward movement forever. Upward movement forever. He said, tell the children of Israel, Genesis chapter, Exodus chapter 14, let them go forward. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 18. It says the path of the just, those who are justified, their path, those who are standing right with God, those who are in the same page or the same page with God, he said their path shines brighter, 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 brighter unto the perfect day. So where you are is the lowest you can ever be in life, in the affairs of life. That's the lowest. You have no other choice than to move forward with God. So understand that the season of revival is the season of signs and wonders. Impossible cases, impossible situations will be sorted out this season. So beloved, key in into this. Number two, this is a season of dramatic changes, serious changes. Things that was not working or were not working before will suddenly begin to work. And then suddenly there will be so much rejoicing. Habakkuk chapter 3, verse 17 to 19. He said, though things are not working, I don't care. He says, verse 18, I will rejoice. I will give glory to God. That is revival. I don't care about the mundane things. I don't care about the ephemeral things, but my joy is in the Lord. His program for me. He said, I will rejoice. Praise God. I will joy in the Lord. Verse 19, you see the work of the Lord begins to happen and God begins to change situations dramatically. Okay. Number three, undeniable testimonies and noted miracles should be the order of the day. That's the way it happens. That's the way it happens. Acts chapter 4, verse 16. It says they couldn't deny what they saw. They saw notable miracles. That's a revival. Revival broke out in Acts chapter 2. That nobody could deny it. That they even called Peter to be drunk. They called them to be drunk. Because they were ordinary people, but they were doing extraordinary things. things that couldn't be naturally attached to them, but now they were working in the supernatural, amazing or supernatural intelligence, amazing all and mesmerizing all. And then God began to add unto the church. First day, he added 3,000. That's the way. Acts chapter 2, verse 47. And they were praising God. That's what revival is all about. So much joy, so much celebration, number four. Because there'll be so much celebration of the manifest presence of God. So understand it. You need to key in into this so that you will not be a bystander, or you will not be somebody who just stays there to watch. Hallelujah. It is a time of God's goodness, of dramatic changes of stories, notable miracles. Amen. No more regrets. Regrets-free. Praise God. I pray you will not miss it. Just understand that God has times of his visitations, like we have said, and you will not miss any one of them again. Jesus wept over Jerusalem, he will not weep over you. May you not miss this time of divine visitation, this time at all. Genesis chapter 15, verse 24. The young man Joseph was prophesying. He said, God shall visit you again and take you out of this place to your own promised land. That's what God is doing. God is establishing his people this period. And I pray you don't miss it again in the name of Jesus. I pray you don't miss it again in the name of Jesus, because God will be working with his people. That is what revival is all about. Mightily and mesmerizing people. Acts chapter 10, verse 38. It says how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power. Who went about? He didn't sit down. He went about doing good. Revival. Healing them that were oppressed of the devil. Because God was with him. That's revival. May you be in a position that God will constantly be with you. In the name of Jesus. Revival time is a time of celebration of the manifest presence of God. Joy unspeakable. You cannot joke with that. Fullness of joy of God's manifest presence. Praise Jehovah. That is what you begin to see. Philippians chapter 4, verse 4. He said, rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice. Acts chapter 2, verse 47, said they were praising God. God was adding unto them. That's the way it was working. So there is nothing. Okay? First Peter chapter 1, verse 8, it says joy unspeakable. That is the mark of revival. It's not moodiness. It's not complaining and murmuring. It's not frowning face like lemon juice. No, it is a time of joy. You see people, you see laughter everywhere. Full-scale laughter, not half-baked laughter, not epileptic laughter, full-scale laughter. And I pray in the matchless and most powerful name of Jesus, you shall not miss this season. In the name of Jesus, you shall not miss it. Joy and rejoicing shall become your new way of life in Jesus' name. Another thing is that it's a season of divine visitation, divine presence of God, where you begin to see turnaround miracles. Serious ones. I want to read something from Zephaniah. Zephaniah chapter 3. This is Zephaniah chapter 3. Almost the same thing with Habakkuk chapter 3. The same system, verse 17 through to verse 19. I don't know. God, the way God arranges things is so wonderful. Praise God. The way he arranges things is so wonderful. Zephaniah chapter, where's Zephaniah now? I turned to Zechariah thinking in Zephaniah. They look alike. Oh my, this Bible, I just got it in Fayetteville here. And when you are using a Bible that is not yours, sometimes you have to scroll, and because this one is a very small Bible, you know, I picked it up from one of the shops, you know, and I just liked it, and it's a Bible that they gave it out for free anyway. It was the only Bible there, so I felt that something about it was transferring to me. So I'm not used to read anyhow. You know, the tiny letters, you know, is actually testing my sight. Okay? testing my sight, and the this thing is not the same way you have. Okay, look at Zephaniah where it is, and that is where I have been with this. And of it's wonderful, just two chapters in one place. Zephaniah chapter 3, I want to read verse 17. He said, "The Lord thy God in the midst of thee is mighty." That's revival. The Lord your God in the midst of thee is mighty. Then what will happen? He will save. That's revival. Harvest of souls to the kingdom. That's revival. He will save. What again? He will rejoice over thee with joy. Great joy and celebrations. Oh, hallelujah. He will rest in his love. He will joy over thee with singing. Verse 18. I will gather them that are sorrowful for the solemn assembly, who are of thee, to whom the reproach of it was a burden. Wow! He will remove our reproaches, the burdens that has been weighing us down. Great revival. Now look at verse 19. Behold, at that time, I will, this is the time, I will undo all that afflict you, and I will save her. Oh, I will save her that halted, and gather her that was driven out, and I will get them praise and fame in every land where they have been put to shame. Revival. And that is what God is saying concerning you. And in the next segment, I will continue with another aspect that will be of great interest to you. Meanwhile, I want you to realize that this time of revival is a time of prayer. It's a time of prayer. Revivals are battled through prayers, corporately and individually. So I welcome you to this season of fasting and prayers. And one thing is to live a fasted life. That is the reality. Not fire brigade fasting. Just make sure, at least you can offer, even if you cannot do the high level fasting, you can do 6 to 12 or 6 to 6. Okay? Mm-hmm. You can say, I will not eat anything. It keeps you even in shape. Okay? To live a fasted life. It burns off sugar in your body. Okay? So that you don't have to suffer diabetes and the rest of it. Okay? So you can decide to do 6 to 6, but let it be constant. Let it be a time that you say, all through my life, I will be on fire. I will ignite the fire of the Holy Spirit in my life from 6 to 6. So this period, we are praying 6 a.m., 12 noon, 3 p.m., 6 p.m., and 12 midnight. So in all our churches, all our locations, we'll be meeting 6 a.m. and 6 p.m. But wherever you are found, you can still observe the prayers. Begin to pray. Begin to pray, intercede. Look at things around you. Wherever you are, there are things around you you can bring to God. You can bring to God. This is the time you begin to learn how to be part of the kingdom movement, how to meet the needs of the poor, how to meet the needs around you, how to pray. Even if you don't have anything to give people, at least you have prayer to offer on their behalf, to offer on behalf of your community, on behalf of your country, your state, on behalf of your family, on behalf of the church, on behalf of God's agenda for this time and generation. So may God find you worthy, okay? So that God will see that you are who is looking for. Ezekiel chapter 22, verse 30. God is searching for people that to stand in the gap for him. I pray that you will be such a one that God will find you, and that you will find your God. Because time of revival is a time that you know your God. You know your God, because those that know their God, they shall be strong, and they will do exploits. And those that don't know their God, they will be weak, and they will be exploited. Daniel chapter 11, verse 32. That is when you begin to know God. God will begin to reveal himself. Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 17 says, God in the midst of thee is mighty. You understand? It is not just the hearing of the ears. It now my eye have seen you, Lord. Job chapter 42, verse 5. Your eye will begin to see the glorious and wondrous things out of the Lord of the world. For it's a time of revelation. It's a time you begin to see the deep things of the word of God. God begin to unveil them to you. Yes, that's the way it was, because the joy will bring it out. Oh, yes, it does. That's the way it works. The joy will bring it out. Praise God. I pray you don't make unpardonable mistakes again. We'll go deeper by the next time I'll come your way. Thank you for listening. This is loving God, loving people, touching life positively, serving our God. I am Fresh Fire. We are missionaries connecting the whole world with God's love and God's presence. Thank you.
Hello there. Are you worshiping with us for the first time? Congratulations. You are most welcome into this great gathering. This is no coincidence. We believe that your steps were ordered by God and He has a plan for you. You are now a candidate of God's revival. We are a generation called to worship the one true God. We do this in spirit and in truth, in kindness and in love, preaching and teaching the word of God by the power of the Holy Spirit. Here, your mind will be renewed as we connect you to God's presence, and you are now transformed into a giant of a strange order. Welcome home.